Okay, and let's start with questions and issues. Anyone has any questions they want to start with? Okay, I guess we don't have anything. So there's a bunch of PRs. So first one is this thing, Stanislav. But I guess it's really waiting for Paolo, right?
Yes, it is.
So have you actually tested it against my command? It works?
I will check later.
Okay, the next one is this one. So what are we waiting on here?
I think it's the same situation, waiting for Paolo.
So actually, have you looked at the last comment I made? So if we do it the way that when the operator is watching all namespaces, the namespaces field is just empty. It doesn't work when you have the resources with the same name in multiple namespaces, or because it creates complete chaos and you don't know which metric is which cluster and so on, or.
Let's bring this offline.
Sorry, you are very quiet, Stamba.
Is it better now?
Yeah, definitely.
Let's bring this offline, please.
Okay. Next one is this thing from Maroš, but we don't have Maroš, so I guess we skip it. Okay, then this is more for info, as that was just opened yesterday. I wrote a blog post about how to write blog posts. So yeah, if everyone can review that, that would be great, but it's opened just yesterday, so it's not something what's waiting there for some time. Then yeah, we have still this Kafka role error weird thing. PR.
Yeah.
Tom, I know you were off. Did we manage to move forward with it, or should we leave it for next time?
I saw this yesterday and thought, oh no, I haven't done any thinking about this, and I said that I would.
I think we can leave it for next time if you need more time. I know that you were on PTO, so no worries.
Yeah. Okay.
So, and that leaves this issue where a user is complaining that they in their cluster have rules that the emptiers always need to have a size limit and Strimzi doesn't pass it. Now, I guess the question is, how do we want to handle it? We can try to add some random limits to each of the emptiers, or not random, but based on what we think they need. Uh, But I wonder if that can cause someone some issues somewhere else, that in his case, the limit we set there will not be high enough, or that maybe if we say that we need 1 megabyte space for, I don't know, a configuration file and a certificate, someone will not have enough space and it will fail because of that. So I wondered if we should use some feature gate for this, or if we just want to add the size limits with some numbers which we think are reasonable, or how do we think it should be approached?
This is empty dir for storage.
No, that's not the one for Kafka storage or Zookeeper storage. That's more about all those different we use for. So we have empty dir where we, for temp, where we create the configuration files and certificate files. We have empty dir between the init container and the main Kafka pod for sharing the data between them and things like that. I think that's the main issue, not necessarily the ephemeral storage. There, the answer is easy. If you need a size limit, then yeah, you just don't use it.
I think we should try and just set a size limit. I think all of those things should be pretty tiny, really. So if we, you know, set something that is generous enough, then that, you know, I don't see why that wouldn't work. You know, certificates aren't that massive, and if we, you know, give ourselves a few megabytes, it seems pretty inconceivable for me that someone would have a certificate chain that was megabytes long. This is crazy.
So something like this?
Yeah, sounds good to me.
Okay. Okay, anyone has any other issues or PRs they want to discuss? Okay, if not, then there's also one proposal opened. I think everyone on the call already approved it. So mentioning it just for the record, if anyone watches that later. And so the next thing is to continue the test container discussion. But if we don't have Maroš, that's probably something we should leave for next time. But I see that Jakub joined. So Jakub, some time ago you wanted to discuss the Litmus Chaos streams related scenarios. You ready for that?
Well, not much. Basically, I have several calls with folks from Litmus. I described some scenarios which I also mentioned there a few weeks ago. The one was for delete the services, secrets, and some of the Kubernetes stuff to see if Strimzi is able to recreate them properly and Kafka is working through that experiment. We basically agreed it's one of the good starting experiments, and we decided that we will create an issue for that, and we will discuss the details of the implementation. And the second, more complex experiment, or let's say sort of experiment, is that we will deploy Strimzi and Kafka cluster, and somehow we will trigger the rolling update of cluster, and during the rolling update we will basically delete some ports or delete services and some other stuff to see that rolling update of the cluster will finish successfully. And basically, we will do the same as for service stuff. We will create some kind of issue and discuss the details to see if we are able to implement it properly. Basically, the main points here are to have properly defined checks before the experiment and after the experiment to see if Strimzi and Kafka are working properly, because this should be determined every time for 100%. And we also need the mechanism which will do the experiment itself. So determine which service or which resource will be deleted. And yeah, that's it. We will have another call on Tuesday. So I assume we'll discuss some details, and I think I will prepare something for the next community meeting, and we can discuss some additional scenarios, for example, or some ideas how to improve the current ones. Any questions? Okay, then. That's all from me.
Okay. Then the next point on the agenda is the plans for incubation. So I guess last time we discussed it around a year ago, the plan was to go for that after we do the 1.0 release. And that we want to do the 1.0 release once Zookeeper is removed, but that seems to be going on. And yeah, if you ask me, I'm a bit skeptical the 1.0 release will be this year. So the question is, do we want to wait for that, or do we want to go for incubation right now? I think Simon checked some other projects, and we would not be the only one incubating without 1.0 version. So I guess it's not a blocker on its own, especially if we have a good reason why we are not at 1.0 version. So yeah.
Yeah, when I looked, at least Thanos and another project that I've forgotten the name of incubated without a 1.0 release, and actually still don't have a 1.0 release.
Yeah, I think one of the requirements for incubating is having a sort of a well-defined versioning policy, which I guess for us mostly boils down to the API versions for the various different CRs. And we kind of don't want to move those to a V1 when we're expecting, certainly for the Kafka CR, there to be some big changes with the Zookeeper removal in Kafka.
To be honest, the incubation proposals I checked, all of them seem to cover the whole versioning thing with one sentence saying that they follow semantic versioning 2.0 and that they do releases regularly with major binary patch versions. I don't think anyone there was really focusing on their CRDs or anything.
Do they commit to a particular sort of time interval between releases, like every quarter or whatever, or just they just say are regular?
I don't think they... So the one... I didn't read all of them. There's quite a lot of them opened.
Sure.
I don't think they necessarily commit to that. They more state the situation. So it's like some of them said we do 3 minor releases per year. Some of them said minor releases done every 6 weeks and things like that. So I guess if we say that minor release is done every 1 to 2 months, then that doesn't really fall out of out of what I saw there.
And are any of them doing patch releases on a regular basis?
I didn't saw that mentioned in those where I looked.
Okay.
Not in in any form, so not said that they are not doing it, not said that they are doing it regularly.
Well, maybe that's not quite the high bar that I thought it was then.
So I guess that was one of the requirements. Then another one is to document that it's being used successfully in production.
Yeah, I was just about to bring that one up.
In those I checked, and again, I definitely didn't check all of them, that seemed to be covered very little. There didn't seem to be a full several page stories about how different users are using the project. It was often just a list. What's not really clear to me is how do these users count, whether they have to be users of the open source community or whether if they are users of the project through some vendor such as Red Hat, whether that counts as well. I don't think that's completely clear from here.
No, it wouldn't surprise me if they wanted the users to be the open source rather than some sort of distribution of the open source by a vendor.
I don't know, to be honest. I think for a lot of the other projects, this would be quite blocking because they often have small companies behind it, which are much more dependent on having everyone as a customer. So I'm not completely sure what the rules are, but yeah, I don't know.
I guess we could ask.
Yeah, I think we would have to ask.
So another requirement is for a sponsor on the TOC. So I don't think we have any sort of close relationships with anyone on the TOC particularly, so we'd need to ask if any of them will be willing to sponsor us.
Erin Boyd's the obvious one. Excuse me. She was at Red Hat until 6 months ago before she moved to Apple, I think. I think that she, although she wasn't on the TOC at the time, I'm sure we had a conversation with her before going to Sandbox. I think Dave Ingham knows her quite well. So we could either reach out through him or directly.
Yeah, well, it's somebody to start with, isn't it? Let's see what she says.
Actually, my understanding was that you do not need to have the sponsor yourself, but that the sponsor will be assigned by the TOC.
Okay.
So I'm not sure we really need that. but it's maybe another thing.
All right.
We can ask. And then I guess there are these number of committers, flow of commits. I guess that's very subjective. How we do in these areas.
So I think looking at this sort of on the whole, I think we're certainly in a position where we could write a draft sort of document addressing these things and approach CNCF to just sort of clarify a couple of the questions that we have and then make a decision about whether to go for it sooner rather than later. How do you feel about that, Jakub, or anyone else?
So when I was checking the existing proposals, they seem to be some of them sitting there for quite some time. So yeah, I guess it might make sense to do it rather sooner. And then if someone says that we don't fulfill something, sit there for another year with the proposal rather than wait for it. And then anyway, sit there for another year before someone has time for it. So I guess it might make sense.
Yeah, it demonstrates intent as well, which is, you know, valuable in itself.
Yeah. So I guess there are three open points which we need to clarify, right? So whether the users should be only from community or also from vendors. How much detail we need about the users. And whether the sponsor is assigned or we need to find one. So who will take care of it?
I can open a ticket with CNCF to ask those questions.
And will you then continue to also work on the draft?
Oh, you drive a hard bargain. Assuming that we need to write, assuming that those answers are sort of compatible with continuing, then I can write a draft, yeah.
So one of the, I mean, it might sound like I just want to make sure that I don't have to do it, right? But if someone, for example, checks the dev stats, then my name pops there for most of the PRs, merged PRs, activity, and so on. So that's why I thought it might be good if someone else opens the proposal to show that we have more people.
Yeah, no problem.
Are there any negative aspects about going for incubation?
Well, there's obviously if we go for incubation and get turned down, then that's a risk that would reflect poorly on the project. But I suspect it wouldn't be just a straight no. It would be a no with reasons that we could go away and try to address.
Judging by the amount of the proposals hanging there, I'm not sure they would turn down anyone. I would expect they would tell you what to do before it can be voted through. So I guess I would expect that you either pass the vote at the end or you get things which you need to improve before you get to the vault. So yeah, it might not be, I don't think it's very likely that you get a no, this proposal is rejected. It will be instead hanging there for a long time until you achieve the things.
Sitting in purgatory.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. I just wanted to check that I wasn't missing something, and yeah.
I think the graduation is a bit harder at this.
Yes,
yeah, so I think that we'll investigate more on the processes, do some security audit, and a lot of things like that, which can turn out to be quite a lot of work.
When I read those guidelines, it read to me like the kind of incubating to graduation was more similar to what I remember of the sandbox to incubating kind of process from when Strimzi joined the sandbox. It seemed that they'd pushed the kind of diligence requirements out to a higher level.
Yeah, I think that is more or less my recollection as well. But I think the graduating was always sort of a higher bar still.
Okay, so are we done with incubation? I mean, discussion about it?
Yeah.
Okay, then I think Simon raised whether we should do another survey like we did last year.
Yeah, I realized I was looking at the results of the survey to see the number of people who claim to be using it in production, just as a to see whether we could use that in the incubation proposal or try to reach out to them. And the outcome was 40% apparently of the respondents are using Strimzi in production. But I then also thought it's about a year since we ran the survey last time, and wondered whether we wanted to rerun it to see how the landscape had changed in the meantime. And if we did want to rerun it, did we want to ask the same questions, or did we want to modify it in any way?
I think we probably would want to modify it. From what I remember, some of the questions were sort of misinterpreted by some of the respondents, so there'd be the opportunity to try to be clearer about what we were asking. And we'd probably want to, I can't remember the details, but I'm sure there'd be certain things where we'd want a bit more detail, and others where maybe we'd want a little, you know, wouldn't need so much this time around. So I think just sort of going with exactly the same format as last time would be missing an opportunity to get a better idea about the things that we're interested in at this point. Of course, you know, it involves more work figuring out what the questions should be. I did a review of the answers at the time, which presumably we could go back and look at and figure out what tweaks were needed.
So will you get back to your review materials?
I suppose so, but it would be nice if someone will be able to volunteer to do it, but I'm guessing that nobody will, so I can do that.
Let's volunteer Jakub or Standa.
Standa, you up for it?
Or volunteering?
Yeah. I mean, I realize this isn't this is stretching the meaning of the word volunteer, but do you think you'd be able to have a look at the outcome from last time and tweak the questions?
Yeah, I can.
I think I can help him.
Okay, I'll try to dig out the documents and forward them to you and see where we go from there. Is that reasonable?
Standard, if you're smart and fast, you should have answered, yeah, I'm volunteering, Jakub.
Or Paolo.
Yeah, or Paolo.
Just in terms of timing, I think last year we ran it during, at least partly during August, when a lot of people were on vacation. Given it's now the end of July, do we want to think about running it for the month of September, when people will hopefully be back from vacations?
I vaguely recall CNCF not wanting to do it too much into the autumn because they had other surveys, Kubernetes type stuff going on, so they sort of felt that August was kind of quite a good time. Not that I think that, you know, that people would sort of anyway, I don't know, but we can try, we can ask them if sort of early September might be a viable time.
Well, I guess if we come up with the questions for it early September, then they will not tell us to wait for next August.
True.
Okay. Anything else to the survey? So the next thing is something I added, release process improvement. I prepared simple slides describing some of that. So I think there are several issues with how we do the releases today. So first of all, the way we do them today, the release candidates and the final releases, you use actually separate builds for the container images. So whatever is tested as part of the RC is then rebuilt from scratch for the GA. So while you are actually testing and approving the release candidate, you actually then kind of vote for it, or we don't have a formal vote for the releases. But then something completely else is released. In general, it's not completely else if it's built from the same source code, right? But it's a separate build, and in theory, some Maven crap might change, the base image might change between the builds and things like that. So it might not be the same. Another issue which we have is that some of the release artifacts are often built locally. Right now, these are basically just the zip files, star.gz files with the YAMLs, or the single file YAML installations. So it's not like the software is built locally. So I think the risk that you have some crap in your Maven cache, which gets used for the build and so on, that's much lower, but it's still for sure not optimal. And then the third thing, which I think is bad, is that there's no easy way to respin the release if there is some CVE inside the base image. Currently, all we can do basically is to either rerun the whole build for the release, which doesn't give us much space for testing, or we can create a new patch release, which, yeah, it's a new patch release, even if maybe the software didn't change at all. So I was thinking a bit about how we can try to improve it. And So one of the things which I kind of ended up as something worth trying was to first use the build artifacts feature in Azure to kind of store the different release artifacts, such as the Java binaries, the containers, and so on. And also have a separate build pipelines for the release and for the CVE respins. So basically the build pipeline will not change that much from how it looks today. It will run automatically for the PRs and for the main branch and for the release branches. The difference is that when it runs, it will actually store the artifacts produced by the build. So in most cases, there will be two kinds of artifacts. One will be the Java binaries, so the jars and so on. And another one will be the container images. And then the build pipeline will also, as today on the main branch, it will automatically push the images to the latest tech and stage the Maven snapshots. And on the release branches, it will also stage Java artifacts to Sonatype. And the Java artifact which we release, so this will be only Java artifact which we release to Maven. And yeah, the things we release to Maven, they are then basically, they have their own release process within Sonatype itself. So the pipeline would kind of look something like this. There will be a build for the build and test for the Java part, which will result in some Java binaries being stored. These will be then consumed by another step, which will take those and build the container images out of them. And then on the main branch, it will also build and it will tag and push the containers with latest labels. It will also stage the documentation for the master branch or main branch. And for the main and release branch, it will also do the staging to Sonatype Nexus. And then we will have another pipeline, which will be the release pipeline, which will basically consume the container images output from the build pipeline. And it will basically take the container images and push them into Quay. So it will not build them, it will just use them. And it will also produce the release artifact. So it will run the make release command, which produce the YAMLs, zips, and so on. And they will be again stored as artifacts so that we can then kind of take them and attach them to the GitHub releases. And this branch will not run automatically. It will be triggered manually on top of the release branch. So that way, what we can basically do is we can manually start it. We can tell it which is the corresponding build pipeline where it should take the container images from. And we can first build it to basically tag and push the release candidate images. And then when they are all good and we want to release them as a GA, then we will basically run it again just with a different version to basically build and release the GA images. And because it doesn't do any build of the images, it just used the artifacts built previously by the build pipeline, it will actually just tag and push exactly the same images which were in the release candidate. So that solves the problem with kind of having different GA images than the RC images. And as I already mentioned, the Java artifacts, which we released to Maven Central, those are done through Sonatype. So it will actually not do anything with those. And in the future, the release pipeline can be then also improved to kind of create automatically the GitHub tags and the GitHub release and so on to make these things more automated. So this is a simple picture of how the pipeline will look like. So it will be triggered manually, it will consume the container images, and then it will tag and push the containers, and then it will build the release artifacts and store them, and that will be basically it. The tagging and pushing actually happens twice here. It once uses always a suffix as a kind of build number suffix, and once does it without suffix. That's not necessarily because of the release pipeline. That's where the CVE respin pipeline comes into game, so that we can actually have the images with a unique tag and they can be referenced individually. While at the same time, we can kind of always build them under the main tag and get them automatically rolled out to the users. So the way the release process would look like when doing the release, you would basically create the release branch and update the files in it, and then you will commit it and push it to GitHub so that it automatically runs the build pipeline. And then you will trigger manually the release pipeline first for the release candidate, and then if it's successful for the GA. And for each of those, you would create the release tag and GitHub release. And then if the RC is successful, you would basically do the rest of the, you would trigger the same for the GA, and then you would do the rest of the GA work, which is currently done manually, like update the website, do the operator hub thing, update the things on the main branch, and so on. And then the third pipeline would be a CVE respin pipeline, which would actually consume the binaries from the Java build and not the binaries of the container image. And it will build the images with the old binaries. So that way we should basically get the, and this is actually wrong. That way it will basically not use the old images with the CVEs in the base image, for example, but it would use the new version of the base image and all binaries to build completely new images. And then it will go through the similar process, the release pipeline. So it will first build them and tag them with the build suffix. And then it will actually wait for a manual trigger to give us some time to test it before we run the next phase and kind of build it without the suffix, because when we and push it without the suffix, because once we pushed it under the actual release, then it will kind of get rolled out to the users. So we should have some tests before that. So the way it will look like is it will be manually triggered, it will consume the Java binaries, will first build the container and store it as an artifact, and then it will continue and basically tag the and push the containers with the suffix. So that will be, for example, for respin of the 0.24 version, it will build something like 0.24.0-2. And then it will wait for the approval. That's the place where we can do some smoke testing on that, or run the acceptance or system tests and so on. And then when it's approved, then it will run the second tagging and pushing of the containers, this time with the real suffix. And when that's finished, then basically the respin is available to the users. So the way this would work from the user perspective is that we will basically find the original release branch with the build and the binaries. And we will kind of find out what the last build suffix was so that we can use it in the container tags. And then we will just start a CVE pipeline with these values as the input. We will test the suffixed images. And if they fail, then we basically just cancel the rest of the pipeline. And we will probably need to do a patch release if we want to fix the CVEs. Or if tests are successful, we just approve it and it gets updated with the final tag in the Quay repository registry. And then after the respin, we will also need to update the operator hub with the new digests. So that's the idea. Some other things which I considered but decided that they might not be the right way to go forward is to use the Azure release pipelines. That's slightly different form of pipeline, but the disadvantage is that it's not configured as a code. So it's kind of you manually click it through the UI and it's harder to reproduce, harder to copy between repositories and so on. So that didn't seem so nice. And then I also considered using more the GitHub tags instead of the release branch for the builds. But I think the disadvantage is that if I create a tag like 0.25.0 and use the build from that, and we found out that we have a bug and we need to kind of do another fixes, another RC, then that would probably result in the tag being deleted and new tag with the same name being created, which doesn't seem so clean. In terms of the next step, I think everyone might need some more time to think about this. So maybe we should kind of see if anyone has already now any comments, and if not, maybe give time for until next time for it as well. But in general, I think we should give it a try on something. The drain cleaner project seems like one of the places where we can maybe give it a try to set it up and see how it works on the release, whether it actually works, because to be honest, some of the things are not completely clear in the Azure documentation. So some of the things might need to be actually tried out to see if they work. And then if it succeeds on the drain cleaner, we can kind of try to roll this out to the other repositories. There's also one open point, which I think we need to investigate. Maybe that's something Jakub can think about. And that's how does this fit with the different system test pipelines? Because in general, we would want to, for example, when testing the respin images or when testing the RCs, we would want an easy way how to trigger against them the system test. So I guess that's something we need to check whether that's feasible or whether that needs some improvements and so on. So that's it.
That all sounds pretty reasonable to me. I think that's going to be a great improvement on what we have at the moment. So thank you.
Anyone else has anything already now? So does everyone agree that we should leave more time to think about it till next time?
Yeah, I think it would be certainly good to clarify the system tests part, since that's obviously a question that we already know needs to be answered, but
Jakub, can you think about it a bit?
Yeah, definitely. Maybe I have one question. Let's say that we will implement that for drain cleaner. do you want to have option to run system tests from operator repository which are using drain cleaner before the release, or you want to run the system test just only for the operator itself?
I don't think we need that. So I would assume the drain cleaner integration into the operators, it's more like the bridge integration. So I would probably expect that once we have some system tests there, it would be more that you open a draft PR, which basically updates the drain cleaner to the release candidate. And then you run the system tests from the operator's PR.
Okay.
The whole system integration, I don't think that makes that much sense for the drain cleaner. That's more something what makes sense for the operators where we have the different system test pipelines. So that's more kind of, if we apply this process to the operators repository, how do we run the system tests for the operator respins or operator release candidates?
Okay.
Okay, so that's this thing. And then the next thing which I wanted to kind of throw out is and more hear what others think about it. So right now when we have the proposals, the way the proposals are approved is, I think that two-third majority of the maintainers should approve it. And I think that's kind of possibly blocking the community growth in the future. If we get more maintainers, it means that you need more and more votes to actually pass the proposal, while not anyone might be active daily in the community and so on. So I was wondering to use more something like Apache Software Foundation is normally using for voting, to basically use their plus one, zero, minus one vote system, and then have something like a proposal to be approved requires at least 3 plus one votes from the maintainers and no minus one votes from the maintainers or something like that. I hope if we add more maintainers, then this might make it a bit more flexible to approve the proposals, because everyone will kind of get their chance to give it a minus one, but everyone will also get a chance to basically ignore it and not approve anything if they don't want to. And it will make it a bit easier because you don't have to kind of push people to review it and approve it if they are not necessarily interested in that area, for example, and so on. So I wondered, what do you think about it? And I guess that's a question mainly on maintainers.
So the number of plus ones won't change over the time. It's always plus three, even when we have, for example, 10 maintainers.
Yeah, I think that should not change. I mean, if you get 6 or 10 plus ones, that doesn't hurt, right? But at the same time, it doesn't force everyone to vote. And it avoids the problems that, maybe one day the maintainers, someone moves to some other thing and doesn't really stay in the community anymore and so on.
And what if we have some imposter? For example, we will have four plus ones and one minus one. Is there any mechanism to ignore this minus one or?
Well, the idea is that you don't ignore the minus one because you respect the other people and their opinions. And you also assume that they are acting in a goodwill, right?
Yeah, I think you have to assume good intent, don't you?
Yeah. But I mean, it's quite common in things like that. You probably assume that anyway for the community, right? If you have maintainer with a bad intent, he can just request nonsense changes on every PR and so on.
And we're talking only here about the voting on proposals in particular, rather than the granting of maintainership, for example. So I think the rules we've got around maintainership can allow a maintainer to be removed if the majority of the other maintainers agree. So I think there is a mechanism. And in practice, having sort of seen how this works, certainly for Kafka, I don't think I've ever seen them. Well, I have seen the threat of a minus one on one particular thing on a technical point, I think. But minus one is basically hardly ever used. You know, what tends to happen is people just don't vote. If you know they're not sort of interested in that, and so sort of things just languish in a sort of a voted on but not voted through state, which you know doesn't necessarily give clarity to you know whether that proposal is ever going to get accepted. But in practice, minus ones don't happen.
Yeah, I think the thing is, the minus one should really mean that you have some very strong reason.
Yes, it should come with an explanation.
Yeah, it should come with an explanation, but it also should mean that you have a very strong reason why this is not a good idea. And at the end, the strong reason needs to be a technical reason or some practical reason, right? Not like, I don't feel this is a useful functionality. But like, yeah, doing this breaks this feature and that feature and so on. And if that's the case, then usually everyone agrees with it and you change the proposal or something like that. So that's why I think the minus one votes are not that common. And for example, so if you check the details on the ASF side, what's a bit more common in some communities is that you can, for example, have something like plus zero or minus zero, or you can have something like plus 0.01 or something like that to kind of suggest that, maybe you don't think it's the best idea, but whatever, it's more feeling than a real issue which you can kind of point to and so on. So that's what we would use, for example, more if you want to show some subjective thing, but it also gives you basically the chance to just ignore it and not vote for it. And at the end, without the plus ones, it also ends up in the bin.
I think I'm... plus one on this myself.
Standa Jakub? Oh, Standa left.
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
Okay.
Plus one.
Okay. Then, I guess when I have some more time, I can put it into a more formal proposal and put it up for a formal vote. Because it's in the governance policy.
Sounds good to me. Thanks, Jakob.
Guess we are running out of time. Does anyone have anything else to discuss? Okay, then thanks for coming and see you next time.
Thanks, everyone.